Okay, it is 5:31. We will call the Dakota with the flag of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Everyone have a chance to read the minutes of the last meeting?
Move your approval.
Second.
What were the changes?
Were there changes?
The minutes? Is there a budget information that was added?
Yes, you were.
No, no, all the stuff, the final budget.
Just the stuff on that.
But what's on the...
Second?
Yeah, Mark seconded it. And it is all... Is there any other discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. We're going to have a chance to look at the agenda.
Second.
A motion and a second to approve the agenda. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Do I have to wait 2 minutes for the hearing on the alcoholic beverage forming?
I don't think so. Audience here, very well aware.
Okay.
Is there anybody here?
You said 5:35, I think I would respect that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Trading business. Approve a letter of transfer or something?
Okay, we move into new business, approving the letter of transfer.
Motion to approve.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. We'll move on to approving O&M billing from the city of Devil's Lake. Everybody get a chance to look at the change there.
What happens when you get water?
It's a new bill from the Highway 20 mini lift. $340.
So is that going to be an ongoing bill every month that they have in state?
Motion to approve it.
I'll second.
Anybody have an answer for whether or not that will be an ongoing?
Bill's not yet.
Whenever it runs water to it.
Yeah, so it's a secondary lift when the other one is not working. Yeah, there's a lot of water going to it.
Roll call, please.
Olson.
Aye.
Lightrod.
Aye.
Brown.
Aye.
Burton.
Aye.
Heisler.
Aye. Motion carries. And it's 5:35, and we'll have the first reading of the Ramsey County Alcoholic Beverage Ordinance.
Well, we'll read the whole thing. It has been published, and it's on the website. It's been available at the county auditor's office. I do believe the auditor has received some comments as to things that might need to be changed, tweaked a little bit as far as some of the language. And I think there was a blank in there as far as under section 11 for locations. There was a setback in there, which is to be really something the commission can look at. There's some of our small towns have got some liquor establishments that are fairly close to churches, and that's they've been there for decades. So that's something that the commission set in there, if you want 50-foot, 100-foot, 200-foot back, setback. I have not gone out and taken a look at any sizes, so any distances.
Were no complaints come in? Written complaints that we should...
Not written. Just people calling, and I gave him some of the changes of some of the language.
I'll go through that. The notes that were here, in page 3, section D, somebody suggested just having it read, "The applicant does hereby consent that the sheriff, Ramsey County, and any of the deputies, comma, the state's attorney of said county or assistant state's attorney, and any of the county commissioners of said county." They suggested removing the state's attorney, assistant state's attorney, and county commissioners, which is probably a good idea. That way, when you have issues as to witnesses being called, it shouldn't be the county commissioners be the witnesses anyway, or the state's attorney or assistant state's attorney's office. So that would be something that is a good suggestion. Turning to page 5, there seems to be a misspelling, the word guilt or line from the top. Should be guilty of a misdemeanor. Then a little bit down further, in that same paragraph, any person under age 21 may remain in a restaurant where alcohol beverages are being sold, accompanied by a paid legal guardian. Somebody suggested just trying to track state law as it is right now. It'd be a little bit, it'll lengthen the section a little bit, but with the commission's approval, I can make some amendments to that for the next meeting. Again, on section 11, page 5, we can talk about the distance. If you want it 50, 100, 200 feet, that would be something that the commission can use some discussion on. Somebody brought up an issue on page 6 about one establishment that has been ceasing business for more than 30 days, but it has a sign up that is going to be opening at some other point. Whether the commission wants to leave that in there, that is in the proposed ordinance, that would be something that you can take a look at. And again, in section 16, somebody brought up the issue of an establishment that does have the live performances. The statute, or the language that was put together in this particular proposed ordinance was very similar to the language used by Burley County. We used a number of different areas, a number of different ordinances putting this together, and that was a kind of more of a along the lines of the Burley County track. The responsible alcohol server training, if you take a look at section 22, that's really what brought this whole ordinance up. Lake Region District Health Unit proposed this. Rather than amend the existing staff ordinance that we had, which apparently dates to the 30s, which is horribly outdated, that's why we're doing a whole new ordinance and including the language in the ordinance in section 22. What you'll find is this language really closely tracks what the city did in their alcohol server training. The differences is that under the city ordinance, they have the agency to put together the server training is going to be coordinated by the chief of police. Obviously, we're not going to have the chief of police do that for the county. And rather than having the sheriff being assigned that here too, and Lake Region District Health Unit had proposed it, we put together this proposed ordinance to have the District Health Unit doing it. And that's something that Ms. Bonney is obviously keenly aware of.
Right. What we're going to do is we still are going to, because the police department does have a trained officer, Corey Wilkerson, Rivas, is also a member of the sheriff's department. I believe it's trained in this area as well. So our mission is to just continue to do this at no charge. We do it approximately every 3 months. Sometimes in the summer it might be a little quicker because there's a bit of a turnaround. But that also also gives people the opportunity for that 90-day period. At some point in that 90-day period, you're going to figure out if your employee is going to work out with you or not. So we're not saying 30 days gives everybody time to settle in and get going. But again, no charge, and it's usually done right there in this building. So, right now, I just want to say right now, in the Devil's Lake area, we have over 102 people that have taken this course and been certified in the last 12 months.
Is that a number of evenings or a number of days or one day or how long is the course?
Course takes 3.5 hours. And we usually started doing it now. It's kind of, the bars have gotten involved so much now that we kind of do a Sunday morning kind of brunch before. Now, football's going to interfere with that. But through the summer, they were actually putting on Sunday brunch for everybody so the bartenders could come in. You know, unfortunately, they had work Saturday night, but at least, you know, they could have some juice and eggs and toast. And so they really kind of embraced it as well. And we certainly appreciate that. And I think it shows their support.
Look at our ordinance. This is not mandated on every establishment. It's only mandated when we have establishments with violations. What you hear from Ms. Bonnie is that a lot of the establishments are voluntarily having their servers come in for the training. And it does a number of things for them. It gives the employees the training to know what the law is and what's required of them. And I would imagine employers, the owners of the establishments, feel a lot more comfortable about that. The only other thing I think one of the commissioners brought up, over the years when we now have the Peterson Arena, which is rented on a pretty regular basis for different things, one commissioner brought up the issue of having, as it is right now, when we give a special use permit to use a Peterson Arena, it's required a county license establishment. One commissioner brought up the possibility of allowing, whether it's in the county or in the city, giving a special use permit. If that's what the desire of the commission is, I could put together some different language to allow a city authorized license establishment to serve out there if that's the desire of the county commission.
I just wanted to add one last to this. And of course, first and foremost, is the safety of the community and the safety of the people, you know, in our area. In speaking with several of the gentlemen or companies in the area that have insurance on these businesses, and these businesses have insurance, if their entire staff is certified, their business insurance drops approximately 15%. And in some cases, that's a significant amount of money by letting their insurance carrier know, but my staff is trained, you know, and I do that just to be sure that I'm a more responsible employer and I have a more responsible staff.
Lonnie, when you talk about the Peterson building, didn't we have a discussion about that this spring, that whoever came from the city had to have the county license go out there?
Yeah, and that's one thing that we can build into this if the commission so desires, to allow other licensed establishments within the county but not a county-issued license to get a special permit, if that's the desire of the county commission.
So if another bar right now wants to go out there, they can't, right?
As it is right now, what we've been doing is the county issued license has to ask for the special use permit to go out to whether it's Peterson Arena or anywhere else.
I think we allowed, when we had the individual come in, we allowed them to buy a county issued permit.
Right.
And then go out there, but they had, so we're essentially saying if we change it this way, we would allow a city issued permit to have a special use permit in a county facility.
Right.
That way we wouldn't charge them the extra $600 for the permit, just so they could
buy the license.
Yeah. Or the license.
Yeah. I think that would be putting them on an equal playing field with the skin city. People do agree with me for whether or not that facility, like you said, is being used more than one of them. It's nice to have the option of hiring who you'd like to hire to come out here and serve. And so if we make any changes, would we just put a notification that the changes that were in place, and then Eric would probably put it on the radio that it was would be open for public viewing at the auditor's office as well?
Correct. Anytime after the first reading and prior to the final adoption, this proposed ordinance can be amended. So this is the time that is the most opportune to change the language to what the commission desires.
And those changes that were suggested tonight were all good changes.
Okay.
In my opinion.
Any other commissioners have any comments on that? So you would amend the language to say a city issued permit will serve as.
What I would probably think about using is language to the effect that any any alcohol licensee in another jurisdiction of Ramsey County, whether it's the city of Devil's Lake or I suppose theoretically city of Edmore, city of Starkweather, any other
licensee. I think everybody knows any of the other small towns actually has a county permit, isn't that correct? No? I thought Penn and
we knew a lot of those.
Yeah, I thought and Webster had county permits, not city permits. But Edmore does their own?
Edmore does their own.
Yeah.
Okay. Starkweather does their own.
Okay. Yeah. So that would make, so that if you were from Edmore, Starkweather, you would also be included then. Okay.
Right, if we're gonna do this, let's do it equally for all cities.
Across the board.
What's the current setback in the language?
I think it was like 100 feet.
So do we have that written into the ordinance?
if that's what the commission wants is 100 feet, I can write that in.
Is that a state statute thing or
no.
Is it? No.
Okay. If it's been ongoing in a Rocket or Lawton or somewhere and it's closer than that, you better watch.
Well, that's the thing.
You don't show their license.
No.
Are we gonna?
No, I want to make sure we're not.
Right.
You know, extending further than we're supposed to. You know.
No.
Yeah, there's nothing under state law that I know of that mandates a certain setback.
Well, I guess my question would be, what is the purpose of the setback from a religious institution? I mean, the Knights of Columbus Hall is immediately across the street from the Catholic Church, and it doesn't seem to have any. You know, it's not problematic to the church operating that there's a.
If you want to remove it, that'd be fine. Or 50 feet or 20 feet.
I'm just asking if there's any legal justification for, or is it just something that's always kind of been in there?
Well, it's one of those things that's always kind of been there, and the theory is to take the bar far away from a house of worship.
Well, I guess under that premise, is there a setback from schools and things of that nature?
I think the city might have that.
Just curious.
Because I remember there was a licensed establishment that was going at one time fairly close to Mooney Age School many, many years ago.
Yeah.
And there were some issues there and requests for variances and so forth.
But we don't have a setback in our language.
I don't think we do.
That's the reason for the fence run.
Hmm.
Maybe you should check into the country code and see if there's anything. If there isn't, I would probably say you don't even need it in there. That'd be my guess. And another question, Edmore, this region doesn't affect that? It's an incorporated city, right?
Right. This was so not...
So they can set up their own definition of, like, rules.
Yes.
One reading, we've got to have another one?
Yeah.
Set the next meeting date for the next meeting then, or is there a longer background that we need to do?
I don't think it's, it just says at least 1 week after the first reading. So it doesn't mandate it has to be 2 weeks or 3 weeks or four.
So can we still make changes at the second reading then?
Yes, you can, and point out to the final adoption.
Okay. So do we need a motion to make these changes then, or?
If you want to do the ISO room kind of thing, and Candy and I can go from the various directors.
I'll make the motion to make the changes as discussed.
You're going to set the date then on the second reading?
Yeah, we'll have second reading for the next meeting. I'll make that motion.
And that will be November 1st.
I'll second it.
Any other discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Close, same sign. Motion carried. Thanks, Lonnie. Steve?
Yes, I had included in your packets a quote for server migration thing, but I guess thinking since we're waiting on till after the election to do this, that it could wait a couple of weeks so I can. More fine-tune it, I guess.
So this 40 hours, is that just an estimate at this point in time, or what are you looking at?
Yeah, just an estimate that if it only took 30, there would still be, at least according to this one, there would be 10 hours extra for help down the road. Doesn't expire.
It has no expiration on it.
Right.
But he wants to be paid 40 hours.
Is that, yeah.
Okay.
Steve talked to me about it, and I encouraged him to wait till after the election if we did anything with this. We wouldn't want to jeopardize that, so. It can be addressed probably, what, 15th? That'd be our second meeting in November.
Yeah, that should be fine.
That'll work. Okay. So we'll continue that under the, under unfinished business and set it for the November 15th meeting.
Table.
Wouldn't hurt.
I'll make the motion table till the 15th of
November 15th.
Second.
Motion is second to table the purchase of technology for switching servers until the November 15th meeting. Is there any other discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Anything else, Steve?
No, that's it.
Okay. Steve Nelson.
Good evening.
Good evening.
We're presenting the final payment to Gleason Construction for the search and rescue building for his portion of the construction. We did sit, Kevin, Steve Eilman, and I sat down with Mr. Gleason before I produced our, brought it up to Candy. So with the adjustments we made, we are about $38 over his bid. But we did do some changes. We changed the apron slab from 20 feet wide to 24 feet wide because they recommended that was a better distance with the length of trailers and things that just didn't quite sit. So we added 150 feet by four onto that. We did make sure we got the deduction from Strata for the concrete, and that's included in that price. So our final payment is $152,048, right?
Yeah.
And that would, like I said, that brings us to about $38, different from the actual bid. And we did also install the stanchions between the doors. We felt that that was kind of important to do, so we did put them in. And that's why we're over the actual building cost, that was there. But it's still within his bid prices as far as what he supplied us for the optional add-ons, so. He was working on the two little things we had. We did a kind of final walkthrough, and there was two issues with the doors, the walk-in doors. He was there working on them today, so. The plan is if we can get the approval to make the final payment, we'll hold it until they're completed, so we make sure they're done before we release it.
He's pretty well done.
And once he gets these two issues with the walk-in doors done, he's done. But he's completed his portion of the contract.
And with this, Steve, how much, we have some money left from our final?
$43,152 left out of that initial $400,000. But I just got the bill about $330 from the electrical contractor, and that kind of shocked me, but it's $28,812.
801.
Huh?
801.
801. But so that will come out of that $43,000, takes it down to about 14 something that's left. But the bills that we have left coming in are, should be very small. hooking up the boilers is left. The company's agreed to, all we have to pay for is the actual parts. They're going to do the installation for free. We got a bill that's coming from Midland for some of the dirt work, which I believe is only some fuel and maybe a couple hours of overtime. And other than that, we're pretty well. We do have the interior work to plumb up the bathrooms, but we can probably buy the materials out of there as well. It's still be in pretty good shape to go over the amount. Well, in fact, we aren't going to go over the amount. So, but we do have a little bit in that building fund for the search and rescue did acquire as well, some of the donations too that we can use for some of that.
So we're pretty close to turning on the heat, or we have enough?
I was hoping it'd be on this week, but I have a question that I wanted on.
You gotta get the boiler on.
The boiler's in the building, and he was there today measuring and getting all his stand stuff, and hopefully it'll be in there and turned on by next week. Is the plan.
I'll make the motion to go ahead and pay this.
Second.
Motion by Brown and a second by Olson to pay the $152,048 to Gleason Construction.
One question, Steve, how far are we from being able to have the media come over and have the tour?
Well, if we get the heat on, I mean, the inside won't be finished with the, you know, one, depending on how fast they get the bathrooms done, but we have enough actual contractors on the team that are going to do the labor themselves, and we just buy the equipment or buy the materials. And the plan was to have an open house for all the people that have donated and kind of have a little some food and beverages, and they can kind of come and check out and see the new. So I'm hoping sometime in November, but.
First?
No. I mean, we could do that. We could do that if we don't have the inside work complete. Yes, we could absolutely show the building, yes.
That'd be a good idea. As soon as you get the heat working.
As soon as we get the heat. Once they turn the heat on, they want to seal the floor. And that before they move anything in. So if the heat gets turned on next week, I'm guessing in a couple weeks we could have an open house.
Oh, good.
And do that. And I can plan to do that.
Maybe can do it the first.
Maybe. Well, maybe. But.
Might as well put the pressure on.
Yeah.
Okay. Any other discussion?
After you get that heat turned on, then maybe we can, now that we know what the final numbers are, we can turn up the heat on the other counties and the other entities, and maybe
I
even...
I still have not gotten an answer from Benson County. They promised us $15,000, and I still haven't gotten, I've been asking, and it just never seems, so I'm still working on that, but...
Yeah. Remind me in the morning, I'll pinch step and see what I can get done there.
Well, I talked to the president of Search and Rescue, and he was going to talk to Mr. Stephan as well, so... There was some hiccup in the wordage or something, how they're going to fund it. Anyway, so that's still out there. of course, you know, we got commitments from a couple counties for a yearly stipend, but we haven't been through a year yet, so.
I do want to comment that Steve's been vigilant on pushing and getting this done and getting the best bang for the buck. I mean, we got a lot of extras here, you know, this little bit of concrete doesn't sound like a lot, but it's a lot.
But it's a lot more than $38.
Yeah, and you know, we got the things to guard the door so somebody doesn't bump into it with a truck and bend the door. So, you know, he's been on this daily and harassing people, you know, the other counties, and he's been on it.
I think maybe Mr. Gleason laughed because he promised us we'd be in there by July 4th. Now it's October.
We got a better building.
Yeah. It is a very, the doors are open if you want to go for a walk in there during the day. It's a nice building. It's going to be. So, okay.
All right. So we have a motion and a second on the floor to pay the $152. Roll call, please.
Brown.
Aye.
Mertens.
Aye.
Olson.
Aye.
Lightfun.
Aye.
Eisler.
Aye. Motion carries. And you wanted to talk to us about something else.
Body armor. We did receive notice that we got approved for a $1,500 grant for body armor. I did put $1,000 in my own budget already to purchase some this year. But now I'm going to purchase as much as I can for as many officers as I can, which is going to be about three. So it's going to be somewhere between $2,500 and $3,000. Like I said, I've already got at least the $2,500 in there. And I can do the other part. That's no problem. But I just need the approval to make the purchase. We have to pay the bill, and then the grant will pay us back the $1,500.
Motion to approve.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve buying body armor for the Sheriff's Department to the tune of $2,500 to $3,000. Any other discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Seeing as it's after 5:45, we will do the hearing on appraisals.
You can stick around. We'll search for what you need.
I don't think so. Anybody? Hey.
Go over and turn the heat up over there. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thanks. Okay. Anybody got the appraisal in front of them? And Paige, or are we still working on? Is this a current list?
Yeah.
Okay. So we need a motion to accept.
Motion to approve the appraisal.
Second.
Motion by Mertens and a second by Olson to approve the appraised value index for county property. Anybody have any questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. The motion carries. And move down to speed study results on Highway 2 East. Just like to report that those commissioners who attended the North Dakota Association of Counties meeting met with Grant Levi and his staff at the association meeting. They made time to have a special meeting with us concerning our concerns about the safety of Highway 2 East, particularly in the Ackerman Acres and Binding Oil areas. And I think that Bill has done some further study on it. We'll make these maps available to those of you who weren't there. Candy was there and she has the maps and she'll make those available to you.
Now?
Mm-hmm. Well, I don't have it available for him, but you can share bills with him. I didn't bring mine. You have yours, what you think?
Let's start at the new Senex, Steve. I'd like to walk everybody through it just a little bit, just so we can get an overview of what was talked about there. They handed out a map that showed the kind of like the current guidelines for setting up turnoff lanes, and what they needed, and they what they used is they used how many trucks, how many cars, and how much speed was involved to determine how long of a turnoff lane that they would use to implement that. So here we're sitting at the new Senex right there. This is very hard to see, but the turnoff lanes that they put in there then would be 900 feet. So that being said, actually they wouldn't have needed those that long, but they did put them in there at that distance, even though that's only a 40 mile an hour zone there. So when you look at those, when you drive out that way, those are a little bit longer than they really needed to be. So if we'll shimmy on out, we'll see what's been done in the last 25 years since a four-lane Highway 2. And if we can zoom in on this, you can see that these turnoff lanes, even though they're not depicted on their maps that they handed out to us as having turnoff lanes, they do have what I would consider being at least a partial turnoff lane there that really does aid the public in their travel through that corridor. And as we move on out eastbound, I'll try not to take up any more time than we need to, but as you can see, almost every one of these has one, especially going into different businesses and things like that. And in particular, the right-hand turnoff lanes going on the westbound lanes, exiting the highways, and the left-hand turnoff lanes. And you can see how significantly shorter those are. They do in their tables and things like that, the handouts that they gave us, tell us that those go down to 350 feet in some cases. And in my opinion, those have served the community quite well. I don't even recall that there was an accident, that Steve would be here to know. I don't even recall there ever being an accident.
So what's this building here?
Went in here. This, I believe, would be the...
The bar and grill.
Yeah, there was a fatality there. They killed two people.
Quite a few years ago.
It wasn't because of a turning lane.
Yeah. So as we shimmy out there, I want you to notice the size of those turnoff lanes. And these are the old ones that are 20 years old. And they've gone from 350 feet up to 900 feet now for what they are recommending. And in different places, like these, they actually, there's probably the traffic count right here is probably 15 or 20 cars a day. And it at that time required a turnoff lane. So, and even going into these frontage road materials, they all have turnoff lanes. And another thing that I want to point out is that they're painted there. In some cases, there is an actual bump out for them. But when you look at a right-hand turnoff lane, if you keep going east or west there, you'll see an actual turnoff lane that is painted. But in those instances, they didn't even have to widen the shoulder to make it happen. They're in particular, they're the right-hand lane and they're westbound lane, the right-hand turnoff. So if you go back towards town just a little bit, there's a perfect example going off by where Shorty Young and those guys used to live. Okay, you can see that.
There's a frontage road a little bit along there.
Yep,
But there's still, it's not that one. You see, which one is that one?
That's the one. The Pino.
No, this is going into the farm.
Oh, that's a dairy, okay.
Okay, keep going back a little ways. Go to this one right up here on the very top of the screen here. Gotta go that way a little bit.
There you go.
Okay, this one I think will even serve, no, this one does bump in just a little bit. But my point was, in some cases, they didn't even have to widen the highway. They just painted the lines and used the existing shoulder. And it does a world of good when people are trying to get off the highway and...
And that's one of the points that we made to them was when they were doing all the construction on the dikes and all the dirt work out there, they put in those temporary turn lanes and then the next thing we heard was that they had to do a complete new study. And that's not true because the turn lanes are actually already there. There's not painted in yet.
Keep moving out and we'll go to where Vern's talking about and we'll show you where that one is. Because I think that's in this picture. Now, in the past 15 years or less, they went to from 350, they went up to 500, and then they went to 600, and now they're up to about 950 for our turnoff lane. Which what happens is when they get out to the binding oil. And they have traffic counts there. I'll just talk a little bit about those while Steve's getting back up. The traffic counts at Vining Oil are running right now at about 1,100 a day. And in the campground that's out there, they're running about, well, at that time they were only running the time that the county put those out there, running about, I guess they don't even have that one on here.
38, if I miss what, 38?
But that's our Peterson's campground.
Okay, so they don't have this one.
So they don't have the big campground on there, but...
So when Vining's were in and they said 1,000 to 1,100 a day, they weren't exaggerating.
They weren't exaggerating.
We sort of assumed they might have been, but they were not exaggerating.
Okay, so here we are out at Vining Oil right here. And if we zoom in a little bit closer, you might maybe be able to see the turnoff lane going into close construction. And what they're saying is that this turnoff lane meets the new standards at about 900, but we measured it. It was about 750, but the one across the highway from it going into the other campground was 900. And so what they're saying is if they put one into Vining Oil, they'll overlap this intersection here and
that
it would cause more problems with the people coming out of that intersection thinking that the trucks that are going westbound or cars that are going westbound, they'll think they're going to turn off where they're going to come out, and then they're not intending to, so they're going too fast for them to turn out and get on the highway. But what you'll see here, if you drive out there, is you'll see on the north side of the road here, this edge of this road right here, and when you come in eastbound, the edge of the road in the median, there is so little dirt, it would have to be moved. If you scrape the grass off there and put the gravel on there, you could make a turnoff lane in there with very, very little effort. And if all you did was just mark it and paint it like they did down on the other end, we should ask, in my opinion, we should ask for temporary turnoff lanes that meet that criteria until they can figure the whole situation out. Because he did say it was going to take another study and it might be very long period of time before he'd be able to get that figured out, because they might want to take some existing turnoff lanes out and incorporate back turns and things like that with them. But when you look at right here, along this road right here, you can walk almost all the way across that ditch and you don't vary 1 foot in elevation right there. So to put a turnoff lane here would be a left-hand turnoff lane across that highway would be very, very easy. In not only my opinion, but I had some contractors out there that said the same thing. And so for safety reasons, I mean, I don't know why, if Steve, can you measure this in between here and here and between there and there? Because I think there was the 900 feet in here. On their map, it overlapped by quite a bit, but they're not really quite a bit, 50 or 100 feet. But so, I mean, if 600-foot turnoff lanes were sufficient 5 years ago, wouldn't 600-foot turnoff lanes be sufficient for safety reasons right now? There's
1,267
feet there.
Yeah. So I'll go up.
I'll go the other way.
Go the other way and go down to 900 feet.
And measure the distance between your green, your turn into Vining and the close intersection there, Steve, for us. I think I measured it at about 900 feet. So, you know, I think to argue about 50 feet, when we're talking about 1,000 cars a day for a turnoff lane, I think there should be some leeway there to add the safety factor and get us a turnoff lane there. And there's signage. We talked a little bit about signage. You could put signage up there that says turn off lane to 89th Street, Vining Oil, turn 200 yards ahead or something like that, like you see everywhere else in the country where you go. I think it's a fairly easy fix to get us by until they can come up with their real gear for everything.
Well, what did they say then on the eastbound?
The
that's the one that I see.
Yep.
So much trouble. I
yep.
mean, people flat get in trouble there.
Yep. And we've got plenty of room there to add that turnoff lane. It's like they don't want to do anything unless they can do it all. And we understand where they're coming from because they have to do a very, that's going to be very expensive to do this whole project all the way out to the rest area. But to get us through and give us a safety factor. I think there's lots of things that they can do with that. Go ahead and measure back to the west from there then.
Okay.
Yep.
And and I don't know where the water goes right there.
It's
but,
supposed to go to the lake. They got a culvert.
There's supposed to be a culvert there, and if the culvert needs to be opened, then so be it. But
the culvert should be open there anyway.
Yep.
All the way back. Yeah.
So
that's where people get in trouble.
Do we have? How much footage do we have there, Steve?
90
We've got plenty of footage there, I believe. If you go back, say even go back to 900 feet right there.
Cool.
Go back to your 900, and that'd be an easy deal.
You'll see trucks pulling the median there, yep. And their back end stopped. They're stopped there, back end, sitting on the highway.
Yep.
Not only that, but when your car is on the highway, if there's a tanker in front of you, your car is actually stopped on the highway.
Yes.
Because mine, I didn't.
And you live out there, so you know.
I work there. Yes. And they come nonstop. I watch the accidents.
So my point is that if we come up with, get some of us together or whatever, and identify where we think they can do something, and just say, can't we have some temporary turnoff lanes, even if it's just the striping? Because in some cases, the shoulder is there on the right-hand turnoffs.
That particular one, there is no shoulder.
No, but there is going.
Yeah. The other way
from the right.
The other way, the traffic has made.
They'd have to fill in the rumble strips.
The traffic has made their own
turn off.
Turn off there.
Yes, they have.
This way, there's no place to get off because it's wet in that ditch.
But you can skim that grass off and put some gravel in there and make a turn off lane there very, very easily. At least people can get around it.
And I believe that a part of the reason that it's wet there and that the cattails are growing there the way they are is because the culverts are blocked.
There's holding water.
They're holding water. The cattails are holding water.
It's the same level of the lake right there.
The
whole idea once was to build that whole section highway up. Up 3-4 feet. They were going to go up maybe more than that. Then they would have had no choice but to put the turning lanes in.
The elevation of the lake hitting 1454.11 is the trigger elevation for that project to happen. And I don't know if they're going to try to wait for that to happen before they do it or if they're going to give us a little bit of relief somehow in the meantime. But it could very easily be done if you go out there and take a look at it.
Well, and it, you know, all the other options that were presented, and there were some pretty dramatic ones, options presented to us that day, such as close the exit to the 89th Street.
Yeah.
Which one?
Move it back to Dakota Dry Dean or
close construction. Either move it back to Dakota Dry Dean.
Yeah.
Or move it so that you had to go into Binding Oil and then take a frontage road back over to close construction.
See where the campground comes out? They said, why don't we make the intersection there and then everybody come back along and I happened to did some research on that too. And all the power lines, the city's water line, and everything else goes right in along that highway, right where it's actually on private property. And so when I brought that up, the answer was that we can actually use highway right of way property to build a frontage road if we have.
But what they suggested was that the county and the two entities there, Binding Oil and Close Construction, pay for the construction of a frontage road between the two.
Yeah, and with those water lines and those easements and stuff going underneath there, there will be no way that they'll ever move all of that stuff. That's pretty serious stuff.
And use 89th Street. That's one.
So the frontage road thing is out as far as going on that
forever turn off.
And then there's a propane tank there too. You can see that.
That propane tank would have to get moved as well.
Basically, the discussion that was had was centered around two things: short-term relief to get something so we can, and then the long-term ramifications of we should do a cohesive plan for the whole corridor.
Yeah.
So that as the development occurs down the corridor, we don't run into these problems again.
Yeah.
Which I think is a fantastic idea, but that's a long-term planning idea versus relief now. And we talked about the different concepts of how we could achieve solutions in the short term. And I think this is something that's at least worth looking at asking for. I don't disagree there. We also talked about the concept of, you know, maybe just slowing the traffic down through the area short term. So at least you would have a little bit more time to make decisions or when those decision points happen. You'll be in at least have a little bit more time.
I believe they thought that would actually cause more.
They thought it would cause more accidents.
More probably than
did what?
If you slow the traffic
down. Slow the traffic.
Because if you look at it, when you slow traffic down in a corridor and it looks like the traffic should be going faster, you're going to have people still going 70 when it says 55, and then you're going to have different speed changes, and you're going to have all kinds of. That's what their assertion is. And I guess I'm not an engineer, so I'll have to trust them, but.
Yeah, there's no streetlights out there. It's all dark.
Yeah.
Yeah, and people are expecting to be able to go.
And that's the thing. That was the thing. Is if it looks wide open, people aren't going to slow down, even if it says you're supposed to slow down. So it causes more problems. And the other thing I do remember them mentioning was, especially on a turn like into Bindings, they'd like to go longer, especially at that speed.
Yeah.
like 900 at a 40 or a 55 is a good distance, but on a like in terms of binding, they probably want to go more like 1400, 1500, I think is what he said.
Oh, I think they were 900.
Eastbound lane, there's all kinds of room.
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree.
That's the biggest problem.
Oh, I agree.
Except for that intersection right there.
I mean, we've been.
Turn it in there.
We would have to contend with that median crossover back there, but I mean, that's something that could be dealt with.
If you watch as they did at the new setting station out here, and they put their culvert into medium there, and they put a cement culvert, not crossways in the road, but they went parallel with the road, and it went way back, way back, and dumped the water, whatever direction they got it going out there.
Yeah, there was.
But they took the water, they're taking the water out of there, and they've got a cement culvert there. I've seen what they were doing one day, and that's what they need to do there, get the water out of there, and then they can widen it to turning lane, and they don't have to monkey with the highway. You know, they're not going to move that highway or move it up or move it over. They're not going to do that. But if you can convince them to do something like that, which won't get done this fall, I suppose.
No. And that's the other thing they talked about is how are they going to fund it? All the funding is going to be set up in the next project.
if you move back now slowly, once again, keep in mind, well, if we went eastbound until you saw the length of that turnoff thing, and then keep that in mind. That's right here. So if you zoom up just a little bit so we can see that. Where to go? Went to a different picture?
Yeah. It changed seasons.
Okay.
Okay. It's not
well, that's all right, Steve. That's okay. That's a brand new one, and it was 900 feet, so.
Yeah, I must have missed the concept of going more than 900 feet.
So let's just, let's
remember the one engineer stating that on, in the higher speed zones, they've been actually stretching out the turn lanes even further now, just because of speed and trucks.
You can see this one's fairly new. Okay, as we start moving back and see the age, you'll get all the way back to let's say back to about quality welding before you really get into the old ones, but you'll get back to the Cliff subdivision and you'll see one that put in about 5 years ago. And keep in mind, there's none out here yet. keep moving. No turnoff lanes. No turnoff lanes.
Yeah, in the study they showed us, and you'll see it on the map when they have it, they showed us, I think it was there two or three different spots that warranted turn lane setups. Mm-hmm. The main turn into Ackerman's warranted one, the one at Vining's warranted one, but, and I believe there was one other location, I can't recall the time.
Okay, you'll be coming up to one now.
I forgot to go back on.
There's a turnoff lane that was about 5 years old now. And just keep moving.
One, they use the whole dirt over
there. There's another turnoff lane that's about 5 years old. And any of those would fit into Vining Oil very, very easily. And you can pile up cars 6 or 7 deep on those. And if you keep moving, there's another one going into the Cliff subdivision. So all three turnoffs in the Cliff subdivision. Here's the one that Myrna was talking about. They took, I'd probably say, over 1,000 trucks a day out of there on this turnoff lane right here. If you can zoom in on it a little bit, it still exists right there.
And now they're trying to tell us they need a whole new study to put it back in.
And,
isn't it there?
And no. it's still there, it's gravel.
It's there, but it's gravel and it's not.
And they haven't marked you that it's there. But it maybe might not meet today's standards. But,
no,
but
so it isn't considered one.
I'll make my point when once we get down the road here a little ways, when we get to the Lakeview Dairy turnoff. Because when we hauled silage out of there, there was a truck coming into that, in and out of that yard of silage every 7 to 8 minutes for 18 hours a day, plus all the dairy delivery trucks, plus all the people that were going in and out of there. There were thousands of
vehicles a day going in and out of that yard, and there was never an accident. And we'll show you the size of that turnoff lane. If you can zoom in just a little bit. So, right there it is. A westbound turnoff lane that held something over 1,000 trucks a day at some time in the past, and never had an accident. And I don't know why they have to have room for 5 or 10 semis piled up before they'll put a turnoff lane in there. If you could get 2 people off the road at a time, I think you could
do a lot of prevention.
You could make the safety factor. Yeah. And keep in mind, from here into town, almost every single approach has one of those. And so people come out of Devil's Lake after going through 3 sets of stoplights, and they come out of Devil's Lake, ram charging, they're 5 minutes behind their estimated arrival time in Grand Forks already, and they're going to pick up speed to 74 miles an hour, and they see all these turnoff lanes, and subliminally they see that, and then they get out and there's none. And people are trying to turn off the highway, and they're saying, "What is the matter with you?" And they go by honking their horns, they go by flipping you off, and they rev their engines up. And we made the point to them, I think they know now. So, and what did they ask for? They asked for one final letter.
Yep.
To say what we came up with. And I think if we want to talk about it some more, let's talk about it some more. But I think just to get some shorter turnoff lanes there built, to build in a safety factor, even if they don't meet their current day standards, whatever you can in there. And I think that would really give us at least 100% more safety.
Steve, I'm going to have you make copies of those maps for Mark and Ed and the media, if you would, please.
4 copies.
Yes. This is over.
Why don't you make 6, just to be safe?
Ponies.
Less ones, people get off on it. They get off on the dirt.
Going into Ackerman Acres, the first one that you meet coming out of town has 70 a day, then it goes to 166, then the middle one goes to, or the end one goes to 44. And this was taken after Labor Day, and probably 2 times as many people use their little lots down there before Labor Day as they do after Labor Day. And he's got 200 more lots down there, 200 lots total down there itself. So, I mean, there's going to be an enormous number of people going in and out of there. And then going into the resort, we had 198 a day.
So they want us to do what?
They want us to send them a letter with our preference as to what to do, and
for safety. For short-term safety.
Yeah, that's how I understood it. I don't know if it necessarily means they're going to do what we ask them to do.
No, but
just what our preference is.
But I think we do have to just sit down and look at these numbers, study these numbers. We shouldn't make that decision tonight. We should get us all together or something, and look at these numbers real seriously and say where we think just short term we can get by, because this might take a couple of years to get this done.
And I don't have too many days for the first trip.
But we got to satisfy our safety concerns.
And the biggest thing is as you said, the westbound lane.
Eastbound lane.
Left-hand.
Left-hand turn in dividing line. Is the most important thing.
Well, simply off a traffic count.
Off a traffic count, it's yes. Imperative. And I've heard every excuse under the sun for not doing it, including how much it was going to cost to blade the turnoff lane.
They said that they thought that 35 or so was where the cutoff was for 35 a day. Mm-hmm. Where,
I can't even recall that.
And even my turnoff has 50 days.
believe they gave, what, two or three turnoffs that warranted a, right now warranted a turn.
Yeah.
And I venture a guess, especially like at Ackerman's there, where there's three turnoffs into the north side of the road where you put in lefts. If you put in a left-hand turn lane on the main turn, I bet you've got traffic on that, at least somewhat, because people will start taking that turn if it's safer.
Yep.
So the other two coming out, people will cross and go right back to town, but they'll take the one left hand, and then they'll come down in their frontage road essentially to where they're going.
Yep, and the one going down to the resort, I mean, something needs to be done there, because that would be the center one for that subdivision and the mining well. But I think we really need to focus on maintenance safety.
They didn't do anything else but took care of that one and left out.
Well, yeah, it's, and I think the problem is there, and I don't know if it's necessarily a problem, but how the state looks at it is a whole problem. How do we address it all in one shot? And I think they're kind of letting the perfect get in the way of the good, you know? We have to, piecemealing it isn't perfect, but at the same time, we have to get some solutions sooner than 2 or 3 years down the road to be preferable.
If we satisfied the center turnoff lane for Ackerman Acres as well, that's 250 a day.
Yeah. If you just put in, I mean, the turn in the Ackerman's left hand out on the eastbound and the turn in the Vikings, I'm not saying you'd solve a lot of it, but it would help drastically. It wouldn't solve the solution, everything down the, right, not down the corridor, but it would help.
And they agreed that when the traffic counts were done, it was probably after it slowed down for the summer. And not only that traffic slowed down, but just the highway traffic itself slowed down. I mean, it was immense. It was intense this summer. The whole price of fuel, everybody was down.
So, what do we need to do? Do we need to write a letter to Mr. Levi?
Well, I think we better get a study here, figure out what we want to do, what we want to prioritize.
Well, I think we understand that our number one priority is the eastbound traffic, a left-hand turn lane on in Vining.
Shoot for both of them there. Yeah, and then go back up here to Ackerman, wherever that pulled that out there.
Okay.
Put that one in there too, but I wouldn't really use more than two. I would hope by hell we can get two done.
Two done would be great.
You know, that's a start, like you say, Adam, piecemealing, I guess. Maybe that's a,
like
the money's gonna be there for that, maybe.
They have to have highway safety funds to do that.
I would hope they do, but I don't, I just got, and I'm not faulting them, but the feeling I got is they're not gonna do a whole lot when it comes to putting in permanent pavement until they've got a corridor done.
But even gravel, you know.
But even a gravel one, I don't know if they
would
certainly
do that.
Certainly preferable to nothing.
But crushed asphalt.
Yeah, well, you don't know unless you're asking.
You have to figure out what the county would put in for mining. I imagine that's what's going to be.
Don't even start with that.
Uh-uh.
Don't even start giving them money, because once you start giving them money, they're going to ask for it. No, that would make some shakers. Safety dollars.
We shouldn't have to, but
no.
At some point in time, if that's what it's going to take to get it done.
So we're going to put money into the state highway to get a turn lane?
Can we look back and see what's...
I agree. It doesn't make any sense, but... there is an 80-20 match. If it's not a safety program, that's not unprecedented, or a 90-10 or whatever. I mean, that happens. Counties put in 10 all the time.
Okay.
When it comes to different projects.
I might buy that, but I can't see the county saying that they're going to put...
No, I wouldn't say that.
I'm saying if we we'll put a match in and you can't qualify as a safety program or whatever, just to get it done. Mm-hmm. We have to put some funding in. I think that's a prudent way to spend our money.
Well, there's two ways to look at this from the beginning. Is the state highway department screwed up, and they let way too many turnoffs come in on this highway. Way too many. Put a building up here, we'll give you an approach, okay. And the second people that screwed up is the zoning and planning. So there should have been some more frontage roads put in there.
And
that's
the,
over and done with. We can't go back and point fingers anymore.
But no.
But we need to address this issue and make it safer.
So at the next meeting, we have to have South Minnewaukan Township as a part of this. conversation, because they are the people who have their own zoning and planning, and that has to be a part of this continuing conversation.
Yeah.
Yeah, we had that discussion down there too about, you know, like you said, we can't look back to the past and change what's happening. But in the future, we know there's going to be more development to come down the corridor and anywhere around the lake. So we need to have that communication between the county or the township zoning and planning back to the county, so we can tell the DOT what's coming in, what we're going to be planning things, so we can hopefully know what's going to happen, so we're not.
So who's on Sullivan Walk and zoning and planning?
You know, you got to agree with me that DOT is the one that screwed up first. Putting too many approaches, well, without frontage roads.
Well, they're going to say that the approaches were already there, and therefore they let them stay.
They were all there.
I'll tell you, the members of the Sullivan Walk and Planning and Zoning Board have only been on that board other than myself for many, many years. I mean, they haven't been on there for very many years.
Well, yeah, they switched it all around.
Don McMullen is the chairman, he's probably been on there for.
Yeah, there's no censors. We got to deal with future, we can't deal with what happened or not.
But okay, so who else is on the zoning?
But you can hold a handle on the highway department's head a little bit, because you started this process putting approaches in everywhere.
Ray Ripplinger, he just got on a couple months ago. So can't blame anybody that.
Well, no, the point is not to.
Can't blame anybody, we've got to just move forward.
The point is not by any means to point any fingers, it's to move forward.
We just did point the finger at it, we said it was the fault of the planning and zoning board, it's not.
No, that's.
It wasn't in the manual, it wasn't even in the comprehensive plan. So does it make common sense to call the DOT and say, hey, I'm going to make a 250-unit subdivision here, is there anything that you need? Yeah, it probably does make sense. But do you think somebody's just going to do that and have somebody tell them that they have to put in a $250,000 approach with turnoff lanes? No, they're just going to do it. You know, as far as anybody's planning and zoning around here, as far as they're concerned, the highway department takes care of the highway. If you make a subdivision, they bring the traffic in. And that's probably the way it should be. But going ahead in the future, they ask that we respect their designation, which is a limited access highway. Highway 2 corridor is a limited access highway as far as the federal government is concerned, when they give money. And so now they want to start limiting the accesses. It's not,
which is good.
It's not old laws, it's new laws, which is good.
What are your wishes, gentlemen? You want
to? I think we should look at these and say how many people are turning off here and there, and then come to a conclusion as to what we would like them to see them do immediately, and then tell them what we think they should do for the long term. But I don't think we should make a rush decision on it. I think we should study it and discuss it.
And I'd like to put a rush on it, because the faster we get a turn lane in that particular spot, well, the less chance we have of losing someone today. And I've been saying that for 4 years, so I don't have any.
If we want to send them a letter and say we want temporary turnoff lanes into Ackerman Acres and Vining Oil, I will totally 100% agree to that.
And I can't make a motion because that's my wish. If we sit here on this and study it for 6 more months, you can be darn sure it's not going to happen in 17 either.
Well, we can say that the consensus of the board was that happened as immediate as possible, and that we will be studying the other numbers and making further recommendations in the future. But those two have to get done.
I agree with that 100%. I don't know how the rest of you feel, but I guess I agree with that.
You think that'll work, Adam? You were down there, right?
Yeah.
Think there's a chance?
Well, like I said, it never hurts to ask.
Okay.
It never hurts to put down our preference on
You want to make a motion or you want me to make it? I'll make it.
Go ahead.
Okay, to write a letter to Grant Levi with our preferences.
Saying that we discussed it.
Those two.
And we will discuss long-term planning in conjunction with the township.
Those two need immediate attention, and the other ones are being studied by the board, and further recommendations will be forthcoming.
Okay.
I'll second that.
Just to note too, I think we should include in there that we still want to do a comprehensive plan for the whole corridor. That we think that's a good long-term approach to it, but we feel that the traffic counts warrant a short-term fix before that plan can be drafted and enacted.
I did forward the draft plan to Hanky, Mr. Hanky.
Oh, the engineer who's doing the plan.
And so he has that in his hand, and he is going to come back with any tweaks to those recommendations that we have in the draft plan as to how we should lay those into our comprehensive plan and into the township zoning manuals.
All those in favor of sending this letter?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign? The motion carries. Okay, we have a letter from the Court Facilities Improvement Grant. And I don't know if the court facilities have, if the third floor has come forward with any.
I don't think I've seen it. I know I haven't seen it.
No one else has gotten back to us.
I haven't heard any talk from either the judges or the court.
Well, it's to complete an application for court facility improvement grant fund. But they would like us to present projects by the 31st of December for the court system. And that would include the both the court and the judges' chambers, and they've both been notified so far. We haven't heard anything back from either Judge Bowie or Carrie.
Do you know what the deadlines are? They usually come down here and talk to us and then bring it forward to that.
In the past.
That's quite a bit of it in the past.
As long as they know what's going on.
Okay. We'll move on to elected official versus appointed official. We brought up at the last meeting that we have no ongoing plan in place in the employee manual about when this kind of thing happened, and that we should probably try to implement something so that we know exactly how we're going to deal with it. I think so far it has always been done that when a county employee who is a hired employee becomes a temporary appointed or elected official, they then follow all the guidelines of being an elected official. And there's some question about that. And in visiting with, I visited with the North Dakota Association of Counties, and I visited at length with, what's his name?
Anyway,
well, and I think Jennifer is now going to be the human resources person for the Association of Counties, and she said that she would look into it. We want to put something in our policy so that going forward we have something across the board, whether it be a temporarily appointed, sheriff, treasurer, auditor, who else is elected? Recorder, or whoever it is, that we have a policy in place.
What's the policy going to read?
That's up to you.
The individual you spoke with, was she going to get back to you when she came up with any kind of...
She just said, nobody's ever asked us anything about that before.
I mean...
And the auditor's office, I called the state auditor's office and they said, I don't know. And I called workforce, WSI, and they didn't know. And one of the concerns is when you are no longer, when you take the, when you go into the position of being an elected official, you're no longer covered by workers' compensation.
She's covered by workers' compensation, it's unemployment.
Oh, okay.
Everybody's has to be covered by workers' comp.
Okay, but anyway, I was asking them questions and they had no answers for me, so I thought it would be a good idea to put something in place in our personnel policy that covers this issue as it arises. And I know it hasn't arisen very often in the past, I mean, probably the last time was...
Katie, myself, Steve Cameron, everybody that's been appointed as elected official.
But it's never, there's never been a question about it. It's not a temporary position, she is appointed until she's elected.
Right.
And so it's not a temporary position, so now she is the auditor.
Exactly. And I'm not...
And so when she accepts the, when she accepts the duties of being the auditor, as an appointed, as an elected official, and she was elected by us to fill in that position. I don't think anything was even, I don't think there's even any question, I mean, it's just the way it's been done, and it works fine.
And that's fine with me, I'm okay with that. However, I would like to see it spelled out in the employee manual.
I don't have a problem with that, get an HR person to put it in.
Yeah, I would say, let's figure out, let's look at it again, look at the employee handbook, find what section we think something like that should be inserted. Chuck Horder did our update on the employee manual last time, so maybe we can contact Chuck, tell him what we're looking to put in, and he can...
Right, why not?
Put it up for us and stick it in there somewhere.
I'll contact Chuck.
Because I think that's, in the discussion we've had in the past, that's kind of our general consensus. The minute that you accept the appointment, you are then the elected official technically. So, it doesn't hurt to note that in the employee handbook. That way it's on paper, so we don't have any questions going forward.
Just trying to cover all the bases. And anything else on that? Can we move on to discussion on the Veterans Service Officer appointment and the Joint Powers Agreement for the Veterans Service Office? We will need to have a Joint Powers Agreement drawn up with the other two counties.
Now, has this commission had some correspondence with other commissioners from the other counties? What terms you're talking about?
No, just through our veterans officer. He brought what they were going to pay and what we're going to pay. He's got all that information, I guess.
Okay.
He negotiated all of his own stuff.
Who's got the portfolio?
I do.
Why don't you look into it and see what you need to do about it?
Well, I don't have the legal expertise to write a joint powers agreement.
I've drafted several, so I just, if you don't just draft it, you need the terms that the various agencies have been agreeing to.
Yep.
Okay. So I have a couple of questions on that note, if you don't mind. Our current veteran service officer, I believe, plans to become a full-time employee of Ramsey County on January 1st. How will he be paid his sick leave and annual leave?
That's news to me.
We talked about it at the last meeting, and I guess it was understood, I thought it was understood by all the commissioners that he was going to become a full-time employee of Ramsey County.
That's
you hear that out?
That's the way I understood.
And they're going to pay, and they're just going to pay their share here.
Yeah.
And help with the salary.
Basically the total budget for the salary and everything was like $58,000.
Yeah.
And so he'll become full-time, the set, I don't know what the technical term we use in the budget again, but the set fees are in what the contract negotiation numbers were from their counties, so they were fine with the dollar figures, so basically basically it's already accounted for in the budgeting process.
Right.
It's there already.
Right, they're paying their share, and that's for whatever days he's supposed to work out of the year, if he's sick or whatever, and he accrued a day off, and he gets a day. Everybody's helping with that.
Was this percentage wise, or you just did, was there actual amounts?
Actual amounts.
Because when you get to the point of hiring people, you put them on a compensation plan, you have steps and wage increases with cost of living, and you need to build that into the joint powers agreement by percentages rather than set amounts, because you set it in stone at 10,000 a year, and 30 years later, that salary is 80% higher, your 10,000 is still set in stone by the joint powers agreement. So the terminology, the terms with which this county needs to tie it in with the other two counties are rather important.
I think it should be negotiated annually.
That's what I was just going to say. We should make it so it's an annual, so we don't get all tied up in it.
Well, a renewal contract. Got to renew it.
Yep.
And that was kind of my understanding too, is we were going to try it for a year.
Mm-hmm.
On this basis.
Yep.
See how it worked for everybody, and if it works for everyone, then we would do a more formal agreement, because they've already agreed to the contract price, basically.
Well, he's already working in both of them.
Yeah. And they agreed to the contract price, and we were just going to try it for a year and just kind of see how it worked for everyone and if everyone is satisfied with the service they were receiving.
And he was just going to be a full-time employee of Ramsey County, basing that on salary alone.
Yeah.
Because, and then they were just going to send the money in, we were going to be writing the paycheck.
Yeah, so we did receive three paychecks, basically.
So what is it percentage-wise at this point with the 17.5 from each of the other two counties?
If we want to, if we want to include some of the other things that goes along with hiring a full-time person with the six-month probation period, we've got 6 months to come up with that contract.
Is it understood then that if at the end of the 1 year that this joint powers agreement is not workable and not acceptable on any of the three parties, that the full-time employee is going to possibly not continue on as a full-time employee?
It would have to be written up that way, I guess is my point, is that it would have to be written up like that. And we didn't do any of that.
No.
And I think we also need a formal motion to, if that is the wishes of the commission, to appoint Stacy as a full-time employee of Ramsey County.
We'll do that when we do the appointments in December. There's lots of appointments to go on in December.
So,
is that right, Elizabeth? Like, you appoint the tax director, you appoint the veteran service officer, you appoint, those happen in
but
December.
But it was in the minutes of the last meeting that he would become a full-time employee on January 1st, 2017. So
yeah.
We already appointed him ahead of time. Apparently.
Well, we just do it, we do it formally when it usually gets done every year, and then it'll be on track. But that's another thing that there should be an agreement drawn up and signed between all three counties. Lonnie could get the specifics of that. Myrna, if you could help me with that.
We visited, we talked about it, we kind of all were of the consensus it would work. At this point in time, we're not locked in on it either. I mean, if the other counties won't agree to a joint powers agreement, nobody's set in right now. That's just our high budget number.
Well, I don't think they'll have a problem agreeing.
I don't think they will either, but I'm saying it. We still have enough time to get it done by the first of the year, no problem. So I would...
Sure, it's a good business on their part to have a joint powers.
Yeah, I would make a motion that we have Lonnie draft a joint powers agreement, visit with Stacy about his negotiations, the dollar figures and everything, and draft something up and then bring it before us when it's ready.
And for a one-year agreement.
I would say a one-year agreement at this point to see how things work, and then we'll kind of go from there.
Yep. And next budget year, we'll have to...
Yeah, then if it's working, then we'll talk with the other counties and see if everything's working.
And then they might come back and say they don't think they're getting there.
And that's a possibility.
Yeah.
That's okay.
It's already happened.
I just want.
No, that's good to bring up.
I just want us to be covered. I want Ramsey County to be covered. I want it in writing, and I don't want any difficulties down the road because it was not understood by all entities.
I'd suggest that you either take the lead or be involved in it heavily as part of this portfolio.
Well, and because another thing that has come up, and I'll put it out there now, and I have no idea when Stacy is actually going to retire, but you know, he has talked to me several times about retiring within the next 2 years.
2 years, he told me.
Well, if he's gonna retire within the next 2 years, and he doesn't take a day of sick leave or annual leave in those 2 years, and he's a full-time employee of Ramsey County, then we're responsible for paying all of his sick leave and annual leave when he retires in 2 years. And at the end of this year, they decide they don't want to do it, we're pretty much stuck. And I'm concerned about that.
Put it in the joint powers agreement that the other counties are liable for their share, so.
Based on percentage?
That's one thing that.
Is that something that was talked about? It doesn't sound to me like that was ever discussed.
It was all assumptions that were made by.
If we recall right, we didn't have that until the first meeting of October that it was solved that way. So it was all bouncing around until then.
Well, we were working on our budget, and all of a sudden, all of this came all together, and it all sounded good and fine, but I didn't hear anything about how much responsibility Ramsey County was gonna have in this whole operation, and I want it to be in writing.
Do you want a motion that the chairman negotiate a joint powers agreement with the other two counties and bring it forward to the next meeting? Go ahead, the motion.
Isn't that what they did?
Did you?
You already did.
Okay, I'll say, you made a motion?
Yeah.
I'll say.
We're talking in circles here.
Yeah.
Yes, can I just speak to the motion? I guess my assumption would be based on percentages, because we hit him for 5 half-days, Nelson has him for 3 half-days, and Benson has him for 2 half-days. So what should be based on percentages?
Of course.
Yeah, that's only fair to everyone involved.
Benefits and it all are gonna be based on percentages, yeah.
And they agreed to his salary already on the dollars, and that's not percentage wise perfect for them, but they agree to that salary number, so if they have a problem with the salary number, I guess that's something we'll have to negotiate, I guess, but they've already agreed to the idea, so I don't think they're gonna, but I know we have to have it set up right.
It seems fair, and if there's any opposition to it, then he goes for the first year without accruing it.
If you have a full-time employee, you have a full-time employee. You don't get to say, but you don't get full-time benefits.
I
think if we call him a full-time employee, he's a full-time employee. And I don't think you can withhold benefits from a full-time employee. I think you'd have some real trouble with.
Well, let's get him in here now.
We'll know at the next meeting, so.
Let's get him in here and ask him. What the invention was.
Let's get the motion through, and then we'll know at the next meeting.
Yeah.
Okay, I have a motion. Do we have a second on the floor? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Moving on to new business. Has everyone read the eviction notice from Matt Tiding?
Move to approve.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. And approve amended site authorization for the Flyway Bar in Webster, North Dakota for Lake Region Snowmobile Club.
Motion to approve.
Second. What are the amendments?
All the avenues raffles.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Then we have a bill for Marketplace Motors that we did not act on in the last meeting, and we need to do that because
The amount on the claim voucher is different than the amount approved before the purchase.
What is the difference?
The original was $33,517.
And what is it now? I'm sorry.
$33,706.
So it's a little bit different. I'll make a motion to approve.
I have a motion by Lifon and a second by Brown to approve the claim voucher for the purchase of the Ford Expedition for the highway. Roll call, please.
Olson.
Aye.
Mertens.
Aye.
Brown.
Aye.
Lifon.
Aye.
Heisler.
Aye. The bids came in for the thin lift overlay, blade pipe replacement and incidentals on Ramsey County number 8. The low bidder was Mayo Construction with $1,205,914.50.
Move to approve. Second.
Take one of them.
It was underbid and they do excellent work, so.
Yeah, it was underbid a lot from what the engineer's projection was. Do I need roll call for that?
Sure.
Please.
Lifon.
Aye.
Brown.
Aye.
Mertens.
Aye.
Olson.
Aye.
Heisler.
Aye. And they will be in the process of getting their contract documents put together and their security bonds so that work can begin on that as soon as possible. Kevin requested a motion to order 5,000 gallons of road oil.
Approve it.
Bill Mertens made a motion to approve it.
Second.
Adam Lifon seconded. Any other discussion? Roll call? No, I don't have to do a roll call on an order, not till we pay for it, right?
Not till we pay for it.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. And we need to amend our budget for the NDSU extension. It was the wrong amounts were submitted for wages in the 2016 budget year, along with the director at that time not catching the mistake. So we are.
They have enough in their budget, right?
Yep.
Well, this is for this year.
It's for this year's budget, not next year.
You got the motion, Ken? Yeah.
Who seconded it? We need a second, Mark? Okay.
So we're just have to move it up $1,466.32.
Yep.
That's right. And I suppose we need roll call for that. Roll call, please.
Mertens.
Aye.
Brown.
Aye.
Lifon.
Aye.
Olson.
Aye.
Heisler.
Aye. Motion carries. You have in your packet information from the North Dakota Water Users Association. They're inviting everyone to attend that. It is scheduled for December 7th and 8th at the Grand Coto Hotel in Bismarck. Sponsored by the North Dakota Irrigation Association and the NDSU Extension Service. Jeff, you going to that?
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah.
We have our December meeting down there
as well.
Thursday. And then the awards banquet is that Thursday evening, where hopefully we'll have a nomination for the Water Stewardship Award and we'll distribute that at that time. But other joint water boards throughout the state present their awards that they have, as well as the state presents their Commodore Award and their Water Wheel Awards.
Okay. So if any commissioners have any individuals, groups, or organizations that they think should be nominated for those awards, please.
Stop by and see me.
Stop by and see Jeff, he'll be glad to help you with it.
That Friday, the following Friday is the 9th, I think it is. They have the State Water Commission meets the following day after all the Water Users Commission, they meet at the roundtable as well.
And I just have a couple notes from Kevin. Just got back from the FEMA project that Silver's working on Front Street. Everybody knows where Front Street is, west of town. Okay, in the DeGrove and Dry Lake area. They have the fill and gravel in place and it looks good. The project did not call for any riprap though, and it could use about 150 yards of riprap to help stop the erosion. Craig told me it would cost $6,000 to put the 150 yards on. It would not be part of the FEMA project, but it makes sense to put it there. I have the money in our budget to pay for it. I'd like a motion to put $6,000 worth of riprap on the bridge repair project in DeGrove Township that Soper is working on. He can start. Bill and Mark, roll call please.
Lightfun.
Aye.
Olson.
Aye.
Brown.
Aye.
Burton.
Aye.
Iser.
Aye. And he requested a surface improvement project on the railroad crossing by Roarville, and Jim Styron, who takes care of railroad project planning and scheduling for NDDOT. They're putting in, North Plains is putting an estimate together, and once they've done that, Jim will put contact tracks together and we will be responsible for 10% of the project. Jim thought maybe next spring the work would start. This is an example of one of the projects that just come up without being budgeted. And that is just for the commissioner's information. We talked about the railroad crossing at one and how fun it is to be airborne when you go over.
Fortunately, buses stop.
You say, I've been airborne on our few days.
Yeah. And that is
it
just.
It needs to be done.
That is just for information.
That's promising that's looking like we're going to get it done next year. That's surprising. I thought it would take longer to get the process.
You want this one back?
It's been degrading. Okay. Well, it's what happens when you go to elevator.
Well,
it
was more like 5 years ago.
No, that's what we're seeing. All that stuff is both.
Okay. Any announcements?
I have something under announcements that it's been brought to my attention, and since we don't have visitors and delegations, I was asked to comment that a former inmate of the LDC, David DePriest, it's been talked about in the community that he was hired by Mrs. Deegan and fired at the law enforcement center, and that he has a felony conviction on his record. And I believe all three of those to be false. So if anybody knows of anybody who's making comments like that in the community, I'd like to have them correct them. Mr. DePriest is in the audience here, and he presently works in corrections.
Yes, sir.
In Rugby.
Yes, sir.
And they don't hire felons either. So if anybody's using that kind of language around, I think there is some serious ramifications if they find out who's doing it. So I'd just like everybody to correct that if it's being said. So.
I see Paula.
Yeah, thank you.
We should make note of the
meeting. Our annual meeting is Wednesday, October 26th, and I'd just like to invite you all to come if you can. 11:30 at the Lake Region State College, and our speaker is Terry Doolin this year. It is our 90th, so it's kind of special for us. So if you could please make it if you can. Love to have you. Thank you.
Thanks. What's the date?
The 26th. That's next Wednesday.
So Kathy said, can I have him tell who hired you?
who hired me at the LEC here in Devil's Lake.
Yeah.
That would be Wes Bartlett, the former lieutenant, and Rob Johnson, the current administrator of the jail. They both interviewed me, and my background was clear then, and it's clear as it is today. I just bought a new gun on last Tuesday. I can't buy those as a felon either.
And you resigned, you did that?
Yes, sir, I quit.
Any other announcements?
Move to adjourn.